In a previous video, I talked about a number of books that I read about the lead up to the United States Civil War that occurred in 1861, and you know, the people's attitudes and the important events that occurred during that time period. And now I'd like to talk about my thoughts about the causes of the Civil War, and I've made some notes that I'm going to be reading from to keep myself on track. So the conflict was between the northern states and the southern states, with the southern states seceding from the Union. And you might ask, well, why did this happen at that time? And it could be because of some trends that were occurring that the Southerners were noticing. For example, the North was becoming less economically dependent on the South, and maybe less likely to capitulate to Southern interests. Also, Northerners had been abolishing slavery within their states and becoming less like their Southern siblings. And even the Southern states bordering on those Northern states, there were fewer and fewer slaves, and they were more likely to abolish slavery in the future and maybe form a coalition with the northern states rather than staying with the southern states. And there was also a new Republican Party that had just formed, and there was fears that some of the disaffected people and groups in the southern states might join forces with them and create kind of a national party. And so some Southerners might think, okay, now is the time to make a break. But at the same time, there was no immediate apparent danger that slavery would be abolished. There had been a Supreme Court decision, for example, the Dred Scott decision, that had allowed slavery into all of the territories. Even on the eve of the Civil War, Congress had passed the 13th Amendment, which called for perpetual slavery within the existing southern states, an amendment that couldn't be amended. And even the newly elected president, Abraham Lincoln, had said that he supported that. It could have been easily ratified by the states. And there was also legislation that was being talked about that would have extended the Missouri Compromise along that line within the United States, where all the southern states would have come in as slave states, and even any territory south, like perhaps any new territories in the Caribbean, would have come in with slavery. And so Northerners were still trying to accommodate the interests of Southerners. The reality was that at the time of the Civil War, most Southerners were not interested in disunion. So how do they get from that place to slowly each southern state deciding to secede from the Union? And part of that had to do with South Carolina's leadership in the process. And looking at South Carolina, initially they had been one of the most booming economies with their rice and cotton, but by the time of the Civil War, they were probably one of the most weakened economies of the southern states. And they were also probably the most dependent on slavery. So whereas some of the states might have been able to replace slavery with some of the European immigrants coming in, those European immigrants probably wouldn't want to have worked in those malarial rice swamps where the slaves worked there simply because they were forced to do it. And also, South Carolina was probably the most aristocratic of all the southern states, maybe in some ways more akin to the British monarchy than to a increasingly democratic republic. Also, South Carolina had improved their tactics over the years. They had tried nullification and some attempts at secession that hadn't worked. And so they realized if they seceded from the Union first, which they did, that other states might follow along. Whereas if they had tried to get everybody together to make that decision, it probably wouldn't have worked. And so by seceding from the Union first and other states maybe following along, it left whatever other southern states that were left as even more of a minority in the national government alongside the Northerners. And also there was a point where whatever remaining southern states that hadn't seceded, they would have to make a decision at some point. Were they going to send troops to put down a rebellion against their Southern siblings? And so there were just a lot of reasons that led to all of those states who initially didn't really want disunion to slowly secede from the nation. What was interesting is it seemed to me that it wasn't any one issue that motivated the South to secede. It was more that they were bothered by what they felt as insults coming from the North, you know, whether those were real or perceived insults. And so as far as the South saw it, there were these folks from the North who benefited from the Southern slave economy, and yet there were some who said that slavery was bad. And so they saw these Northern Yankees as being kind of moralizing hypocrites, which would have been true. But for a lot of years, there really was just kind of more of an apathy from the North concerning slavery in the South. And they didn't really consider, you know, okay, you guys do your thing down there as long as you're not bothering us. And it wasn't until slaveholders started kind of pushing their interests and forcing that on the North that more broadly in the North, they became increasingly antagonistic towards the South. But even then, there would just be some individuals or groups who would insult the South, and then the South would reflect that as, wow, this whole entire region is insulting us. So for example, John Brown was just an individual guy who tried to have a slave uprising in Virginia, and there were some in the North who supported him. But then Southerners would say, well, look then, everybody in the North supports this slave uprising, which wasn't the case. And so there was kind of almost this outsized Southern outrage against the North that wasn't really reflected in reality. Also, the new Republican Party had come along. It was the first time that a party had outright said that slavery is wrong. You know, they did say that the current Southern states had a right to slavery through the Constitution, but they said slavery was wrong, which was an insult to the South, they felt. And it just made me think how flimsy this fiction that some slaveholders told about slavery. You know, there were some slaveholders who said, you know, slavery is wrong and eventually it'll go away. But then there were other slaveholders who said that, you know, blacks are inferior, that slaves are happy and they're happy in their natural condition. And so when they could see with their own eyes that this wasn't true and it would be kind of reinforced with these insults from the North, because they could see, like in South Carolina, there were slaves who were overseers of those rice plantations. And so obviously they were capable. Freed slaves became successful, and so they were capable. And there were slaves who were fleeing slavery, and so obviously they weren't happy. And eventually, even during the Civil War, when the South was trying to find more people to fight, they thought maybe they would make slaves into soldiers. And then they thought to themselves, well, if slaves are successful as soldiers, then obviously they're not inferior. And so all of these things that they could see with their own eyes showed that their fiction was not a reality. And so any of these insults just came too close to the truth. Also, slaveholders had always said, you know, if we're going to end slavery, we're going to do it when and how we're going to do it. And Northerners aren't going to tell us. And so any suggestion that slavery should end was an insult to the South. And also, even just the idea that the South thought we have a right to secede from the Union, if the North suggested that it wasn't something that should be allowed, that was an insult to the rights of those in the South. And so it just seemed to me that a lot of these slaveholders had this disproportionate power within the nation for so long, and as that seemed to be turning, perhaps, that, you know, they were just insulted by the whole thing. Other contributing reasons for the split may have been simply because the North and the South were becoming culturally and economically more and more different, and so it was easier to identify oneself with one or the other region. And also, I wondered if there was some way that national leadership might have avoided secession. So a lot of this talk of secession and work towards it occurred under the current president of the Democratic Party, Buchanan. And it wasn't till later that Lincoln was elected and, you know, took over the position. And so people were kind of in this big state of agitation. Could there have been a way to wait and let tempers cool? But, you know, it did seem like that they did try to calm tempers and wait. And it just, you know, the agitation continued and secessions continued. So I don't know that there was any way for national leadership to stop what was happening. I don't know. It also seems that if rebellious Southerners had kind of thought this through, they would have seen that secession probably wasn't going to work out too well when they already had a lot of these internal cracks within their society in the South. So, for example, we talked about the Southern slaveholders who actually felt like slavery was wrong and that eventually it would go away, and that slaves would eventually be replaced by European immigrants. And so they weren't very strong on slavery. Obviously, the Southern non-slaveholders, many of them resented the disproportionate power that slaveholders had in government, and they didn't want to leave the Union. And then, there's all these poor Southerners that really didn't benefit from slavery other than as their status as white people. And, you know, would they be willing to die for that sort of status? And then, of course, there were all the slaves that weren't interested in slavery. And in fact, they were in a lot of ways the cause of this split, because by them running away, there was always this push by the South to make the North help them, you know, protect our property with fugitive slave laws and such, which caused this antagonism between the North and the South.
The South would need all of itself in order to whip the more numerous, more industrialized Yankees. Instead, too many Southern folk controlling too much Southern industry and strategic terrain would support the Union. These Southern anti-Confederates, including at least 100,000 Middle South whites, two-thirds of Border South whites, and some 500,000 fugitive slaves, would help turn the secessionist panacea into a suicidal gamble.
Also, it just doesn't seem possible that slavery could survive, you know, this aristocratic institution, really, could exist within a democratic republic where the idea was that everyone had individual rights. And beyond the nation, there were other countries in the world who didn't believe that slavery was morally right anymore. And so the South was to find this during the Civil War that they couldn't get support from outside countries as long as the main point of their new nation was to perpetuate slavery. I was thinking, I had a related question about this, you know, should the states have just been allowed to secede? Maybe that was right. We think about divorce when two people are no longer getting along. Maybe they should just go their separate ways. And I found it interesting in my reading that the founding fathers even talked about secession being possibly an inevitability. Even that early on, they were thinking that, but I couldn't tell whether they thought that it would be acceptable or if they thought that it shouldn't be allowed. In The Road to Disunion, the author talks about how in a democracy that there's majority rule, and it requires sometimes that people are winners and sometimes that they're losers, and there has to be an acceptance of those results or it's just not going to work out. And he includes information about Andrew Jackson, who was a president from the South, who thought that, you know, if a state was going to suggest secession or nullification, like South Carolina was doing when he was president, that it would have to be, you know, a pretty extreme oppression. It couldn't just be something like, oh, tariffs or insults or something that somebody feared might happen in the future.
The Southern president went out of his way to attack that Southern position. In his Nullification Proclamation of December 10, 1832, Jackson called secession a revolutionary act to be morally justified by the extremity of oppression. A tariff about to be changed was hardly extreme oppression, nor was a morally justified revolution a legally justified act. Governors, by the law of self-defense, could repress an attempt by force of arms to destroy a government. He would save majoritarian union from traitorous minorities, whether lawbreakers called themselves nullifiers or disunionists.
I also wondered if the cause of the Civil War didn't go back to the writing of the Constitution by the Founding Fathers. When I was reading this three-fifths book, which dealt with constitutional issues concerning slavery, it seemed like, you know, actually I was really surprised at how opposed some of those folks were to slavery. I had always kind of thought, as the Founding Fathers, like, oh, whatever, slavery, slaves will be three-fifths of a person, whatever. But there were some that were just vehemently opposed to it. And I wonder if they had been able to get, like, a moratorium on slavery in the Constitution, if that could have helped it, you know, before it became entrenched and spread and it became much harder to get rid of slavery. You know, there were some few Southern states that said, if slavery doesn't continue, then we won't be part of this union. And the North at that time was much more dependent on the South economically, and there were a lot of debts from the Revolutionary War. But I wonder, in here, Governor Morris talks about how the South needed the North just as much as it was the reverse. And if the North had just pressed on this issue, that the South might have said, oh, well, actually, it's better if we join this union, and would have agreed to some sort of slavery moratorium. But yeah, here I am being kind of just an armchair writer of the Constitution. But if the North had gambled and the South had decided not to join the Union under this new Constitution, then the South could have formed alliances with a foreign government and then been a real big threat to the North under the conditions where they were kind of weakened economically. So that was a big gamble. And, you know, maybe James Madison was right that if they gambled and the South formed their own nation, then the slaves would be trapped within that nation with no chance of ever becoming freed. But then I thought that it was ironic that, you know, under the Constitution, the North and the South, they perpetuated slavery anyway. So the slaves were trapped in this new nation as slaves. And in fact, on the eve of the Civil War, they were talking about slavery being perpetuated forever. So I don't know. That's crazy. And then I think about how if Lincoln had decided that it was acceptable for the Southern states to secede and form their own nation, then the slaves would have been trapped in this separate nation, and who knows how long they would have been, you know, they wouldn't have been freed for decades, for a very long time. And so it was probably best that he tried to put down that rebellion. Anyway, that's me again being my armchair constitutional convention. I just feel like knowing now that the founding fathers, many of them knew that it was morally wrong to continue with slavery, including some slaveholders like Jefferson, that, you know, they shouldn't have allowed it. Me, constitutional convention. So those are my thoughts on the lead up to the Civil War. And, you know, I might go on to read more about this topic, if you can believe it. I kind of like to take my own advice and read a concise history so that I know that I've got the people, places, dates pinned down. But I'd also like to learn a little bit more where I still have kind of gaps in my understanding. I'd like to know more about cotton and how it impacted the nation. And also just that short period right before the Civil War, you know, what did President Buchanan and President-elect Lincoln and President Lincoln do that might have affected the outcome? Could it have prevented the Civil War? And also, I'm curious about Reconstruction after the Civil War. I always hear these ideas about how, you know, Reconstruction didn't really work. I just don't feel like I know much at all about that. And also, one of the questions that caused me to start looking into this in the first place is that a lot of people talk about how, you know, the United States is on the brink of another civil war. And just looking at what was going on back then and what is going on right now. And are there any similarities that would suggest that we're on the brink of civil war right now? And so, yeah, more reading on this subject later, but later. Done.